Welcome everyone to this Monash Cybersecurity Seminar. So we are happy to welcome Tim Ruffing today. So Tim is an applied cryptographer in the research team of Blockstream, a Bitcoin and blockchain technology company. Tim obtained his PhD from Saarland University, researching cryptographic aspects of cryptocurrencies. His current research focuses on advanced applications of Schnorr signatures, for example, to multi and threshold signatures. Tim also serves as a co-maintainer of libsigp256k1 library, which is a cryptographic open source library used in Bitcoin Core. And today, Tim will talk about MUSIC2, simple two-run Schnorr multi-signatures. So the scene is yours, Tim. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction. Let me try to share my screen again. Can you see it?
Yeah, all good.
You should? Okay, great. Yeah. So yeah, as I said, thanks for the intro. Thanks for having me. This talk is about our work, MUSIC2, simple two-round Schnorr multi-signatures. And this is what I'm presenting today is joint work with Jonas Nick and Yannick Serra. So what are multi-signatures? The idea of a multi-signature is that you have some set of n signers and they work together to produce a single signature on a single message. And I said they work together, so the signing protocol here can be interactive. And just to make distinction for the purpose of this talk, when I say multi-signatures here, I refer to what people, for example, in the cryptocurrency space call n of n. So you need all signers to be present, as opposed to threshold signatures where you have some smaller threshold T, which can be smaller than N, and you only need a certain number T of signers to be present to really sign a message. So this talk is only about the first thing, multi-signatures, N of N. So why are those interesting for cryptocurrencies and for Bitcoin? In a nutshell, if you have a multi-signature scheme, you can organize shared ownership of Bitcoin, right? So you can store your coins under some public key that belongs to not a single signer, but a set of signers, and this represents shared ownership. And this is useful in many applications that we can build on top of Bitcoin. The very simple thing is just secure storage. So maybe you want to split your secret signing key across multiple devices just for having a higher level of security. But we can also have more sophisticated applications if you have multi-signatures, for example, things that build on smart contracts, such as payment channels. Mentioned the Lightning Network here at Blockstream. We are working on a federated sidechain called Liquid that also would benefit from these features and so on. So the thing is that as soon as you have a spending condition that involves more people, and maybe people call this would want to call this a smart contract, then usually you have to move your coins to a place where they can be only spent if all of the people agree, except there may be some escape conditions. But the general idea is that you want to move them to UTXO where all the involved people need to agree to spend that. And this is exactly where we can make use of multi-signatures. And Bitcoin, in fact, supports multi-signatures or some form of multi-signatures, but it's a very, it's a trivial way to implement it. Let's say you have a standard signature scheme, and now what you can do is if you have n participants with n public keys, well, just let's say the combined public key is simply the concatenation of all those keys. And then the combined signature, it's not really combined, right? But it's just, just the concatenation of all the signatures. And it's kind of easy to see that this works, and this is currently deployed in Bitcoin using ECDSA signatures. And it has even one great feature. It's non-interactive, so it's basically just really one communication round, or if at all. So if you want to create a signature, everybody just signs locally and broadcasts the signature. But it has many drawbacks. And the obvious drawback here is that the size is linear in the number of signers. And this applies to both the public key and the signature. And this is kind of undesirable for blockchains because we both need to store both the public key and the signature on the chain. So and both of these elements are of linear size then. The background, so to say, of our work is that hopefully in the future we will have support for Schnorr signatures in Bitcoin. And for example, there's a concretely there is a Bitcoin improvement proposal which I also co-authored, which is currently discussed on how to how it should be activated on Bitcoin, and this will, if it's really activated, will introduce Schnorr signature support in Bitcoin. And the motivation to move to Schnorr signatures instead of ECDSA is like if you you probably know the story, the provable security of ECDSA is pretty difficult. Of course, it seems to be fine in practice, so that's not really a big reason to switch to Schnorr signatures, but it's still a good reason. Second thing is that simply they are a little bit more efficient. And but the large motivation to use Schnorr signatures is that they allow for easier constructions of advanced signing protocols. For example, multi-signatures, but also other advanced signing protocols. So the vision here is that on-chain, so to say, we have support for Schnorr signature verification. So this is really consensus code, but the consensus code is simple and only understands Schnorr signature verification. But then this allows us to build advanced signing protocols on top of it without changing the without a need to change the consensus code every time. So for example, we can build multi-signatures on top of this. We could also build threshold signatures on top of it. We could maybe build Schnorr blind signatures on top of it and other protocols. As long as the result of your protocol looks like a Schnorr signature, you could put it on the blockchain. This is the idea here. And this design is pretty neat because the on-chain consensus layer is kept simple. And all the complexity is moved to the to off-chain protocols. And this is not only good for efficiency and for simplicity, it's also good for privacy. Because what ends up on-chain is just a normal Schnorr public key and the normal Schnorr signatures. And just from looking at the chain, an observer cannot see that in fact some complex protocol was going on in the background. So this is also good for privacy. And last but not least, it's good for efficiency because everything is O1. So this would O1. So this would solve the problem that I mentioned on the previous slide. But to make this vision work, what we need is a multi-signature scheme that output signatures that look like ordinary Schnorr signatures. So the idea is really that on-chain you have only this thing, Schnorr signature verify, which takes a public key, a signature, and a message. And this is really an ordinary Schnorr signature as produced by it would have been produced by a single signer and a single public key. And so to make this work, we need a interactive signing protocol that the end signers can run to produce the single signature that looks like a normal signature. And we also need to deal with the public key. And here what we want to have is that the public key again looks like a normal Schnorr signature public key. And in this case, we even want the neat feature that it should be possible to obtain this public key via a non-interactive public algorithm that I call key aggregation here. So the idea is that everybody can just take a bunch of public keys, put them into the key aggregation algorithm, and then gets this aggregated public key tilde pk. And then you could send money to this aggregated key without the need to interact again with the signers. You just need the public keys locally, and then you can build this aggregate key. So this is the protocol we would, or this is the primitive we would need to make this work. And I call this for the rest of the talk a fully compatible Schnorr multi-signatures. And now if you look at the literature and look at existing schemes, there are a few schemes in the literature. One nice scheme with this property is the music scheme, which I also call music one here, but to make sure I don't mess it up, don't mix it up with our work, music two here, proposed by Maxwell et al. The neat thing about this work is that it works in the public key model. So other multi-signature schemes often use proofs of possession to make sure that there are no rook key attacks and so on. So signers need to prove that they, in fact, know the secret key belonging to their public key. So you need to attach some zero knowledge proof. Music avoids this. But the main drawback of this scheme is still that it's a three-round signing scheme. We recently worked on another variant of music, which is called music DN, and DN here is for deterministic nonsense. The goal of this work was in fact not to have a two-round scheme, but really to get deterministic signing, which prevents you from having random, really random failures and randomness generation. It could be catastrophic. The thing here is that usually when you have DL-based signatures like ECDSA or Schnorr-based signatures, you need a random nonce. So you need some randomness during the signing process. And for local signatures, you usually generate this randomness using a deterministic process, for example, a PRG. And this protects from certain catastrophic failures where if you reuse the randomness, then everybody could extract your secret key. Interestingly, you can't do this for multi-signatures, at least not naively. And in this work, we make it work for multi-signatures. The tool we use here is just large enough hammer. So we add this expensive zero knowledge proof, and then you can make it work. And the side effect of this is that you really get a two-round signing scheme. So we managed to get rid of one round and obtain a two-round scheme. But this protocol is not at all simple, right? And I promised you to construct simple signatures. These are really kind of snark-like zero knowledge proofs, and this is pretty complex to deploy and to reason about. So what's the thing about two-round schemes? Interestingly, an early revision of this Music One work was in fact a two-round scheme. And so the first version that appeared on ePrint described a two-round signing protocol. But a flaw in the security proof was discovered, and we'll see this later in the talk, by Travis et al. At Oakland 19, and they in fact didn't even show that the proof was flawed, but they also gave a practical attack against the scheme that works with the sub-exponential complexity. It's we're still not the polynomial runtime, but it was practical. So in practice, the scheme was broken. And they, in fact, even gave a meta reduction that rules out security proofs against polynomial adversaries. Now at Eurocrypt 2021, so this is very recent work, this forgery was in fact improved, and now it's the running time is polynomial. It's in fact trivial. So probably you can do this forgery on your pocket calculator if you spend some time. And maybe I should point out here that the issue in the protocols is that the issue here is always that if you run multiple sessions in concurrently, then the protocol is vulnerable to those attacks. But of course, we want a scheme that is secure under concurrent sessions, because it might be very hard in practice to enforce that you run only a single session. So, in the light of these attacks, MUSIC1 needed to change to a 3-round scheme, and this is what the actual MUSIC1 schemes look like. It has 3 rounds. Okay, and so the outline of the rest of the talk this is more a technical part. So by the way, feel free to interrupt and ask questions, right? This should be a seminar or lecture style talk. So whenever there's something that you don't understand, just interrupt me. The outline of the, let's say, technical part of the talk is that we first have a look at how Schnorr signatures actually look like, and then we will have a look at MUSIC1 and see why it's a 3-round protocol. So why, in fact, the attempted reduction of the number of rounds failed, and why the security proof didn't work out. And then we will see how to fix this idea and really obtain a secure two-round scheme, MUSIC2, which will then be a 2-round scheme. And sometimes it's actually better than 2 rounds. We'll see that. So are there questions up to that point? I guess no.
Questions so far?
Yep, great. Then just let's go ahead. Warm up, Schnorr signatures. Schnorr signature scheme, you have a secret key X, and the public key is, it's DLOG based, the public key is G to the X, and I sometimes write X. I mean, when I talk about a concrete scheme, I usually write X. When I talk about a generic multi-signature scheme, I write PK, so bear with me, sometimes you need to translate those. Then design algorithm, it starts by drawing a random nonce. This is what I mentioned. Here I wrote it as a random thing, but as I said, usually it's some deterministic derivation that involves the secret key and a message. We compute a public key, a public part of this nonce, which is just G to the nonce R. So this is a Fiat-Shamir style signature of knowledge protocol. So we compute a challenge C using a hash function hsig applied to our public nonce R and M. And we also hash in the public key to make sure we don't mess up with context. Then we have this challenge C, and then we can compute a response to this challenge, which is value S, just X times the challenge, so the secret key times the challenge, blinded by the nonce. And then the final signature is the public part of the nonce R and S. And this is the signature we can return. And on the verification side, it looks kind of pretty similar. The verifier recomputes the challenge because it, I see I messed up already on the first slide. Okay, sorry for that. So X is the public key. So the verifier recomputes the challenge because it has all the elements, has the public key, it has R, it has M. And then it checks this main equation here in terms of public elements. Yeah, and if this holds, then the signature is valid. Okay, how can we build multi-signatures on top of Schnorr signatures or using Schnorr signatures? a strawman approach is that we exploit the linearity in the main equation that you've seen. And there are two parts to this. The first thing is the public key. And here we can have, so let's say we have two signers with public keys x1 and x2. And here we, in order to combine the public key, we can just simply try to multiply those two keys and get an aggregate key tilde x. And the second part we have to combine is the nonces. And here that's basically the same idea. Everybody now in an interactive protocol would send their nonce. And then we obtain a combined nonce just by multiplying those. And now that we have a combined key, we have a combined nonce, we can just compute the challenge as usual. And then everybody can solve this challenge on their own and can send their values S1 and S2. And if we add them up, we get a combined value S. And due to the fact that this verification equation is homomorphic in a sense, or it's linear in X and in R, so RS is a valid Schnorr signature for this combined key X. So this in fact works, but it's, I call it strawman multi-signatures. The problem here is that it's just not secure, and there are two issues. And MUSIC1 solves those issues. So the first issue is that I mentioned this earlier, there could be rogue key attacks. So what's a rogue key attack? And a rogue key attack, one of the signers chooses his public key depending on the public keys of the other signers. And this is a very, let's say, old problem in multi-signatures has been known since the 80s. And the way MUSIC1 solves that was kind of new. Instead of sending zero knowledge proofs, what's done in MUSIC2 is that the keys here are not just not simply multiplied, but there are additional exponents that are derived via a hash function. And this is a neat way to solve those rogue key attacks. And I won't go into detail in that part. Just remember we have those coefficients. And the second thing, and this is where it gets interesting when it comes to number of rounds, is that in fact, MUSIC1 has a third round here, or it's the first round, but it's an additional round that runs before those two rounds. And what happens here is that everybody needs to commit to their nonce before they really send it. So this is a commit and reveal protocol, and again, we use a hash function here to perform this commitment. So why do we need this additional commitment round? To explain this, we need to look at the at how we would prove security of this MUSIC1 scheme in the random oracle model. So let me first tell you what security in fact is. So we have a unforgeability game for multi-signatures, and it's pretty natural, I'd say. So it starts by the challenger drawing key pair SK1, PK1 for one honest user. So we assume there's just one honest user in the entire world. And this user is played by the challenger, and without loss of generality, we give it index 1. So the challenger creates a key pair for this honest user and invokes the adversary, sending him the public key of the honest user. And now what the adversary can do is ask for arbitrary signing sessions, where in those signing sessions, the challenger will play the honest user with the corresponding secret key. And the adversary can ask for arbitrary messages, and it can ask for arbitrarily set of signers L, as long as the honest user is in the set, right? Because otherwise, it's kind of pointless. If you have only if there are only other keys, then the oracle is not needed for the adversary. But apart from the fact that the requirement that the honest public key needs to be in the set, the adversary can arbitrarily choose the other public keys. So all the other keys will be controlled by the signer, and also during the signing session, the adversary will control all the other signers. And in the end, the adversary will output a forgery, hopefully. That I here call sigma star, m star, l star. What's the condition that this is valid? Well, so it should be valid for some set L star. So we first, in order to be able to verify it, we first build the aggregate's public key here using the key aggregation algorithm, and then we can run the verification algorithm which now takes the aggregate public key, the message and the signature. Of course, this needs to be a valid signature. Another condition is that this in fact needs to be a signing set where the honest user is involved, right? Because otherwise the adversary can just could just output a forgery where it controls all the secret keys and all the public keys and the secret keys, and this is of course trivial. And we need to make sure that the adversary never asked for a signing session with those specific parameters, because then it could just use the result of the signing session and output it as a forgery. Okay, so this is the unforgeability game. And how would we now, with this in mind, how would we prove security of MUSIC1 under a discrete logarithm in the random oracle model? So we're giving a successful forger A, and we want to build a reduction B against discrete logarithm. And what I show you here is only a sketch, but we will go into the details, of course. And so so we get a DL challenge from our challenger, let's call it U. And we simply sell this as our honest public key to the adversary. And we run the adversary with this public key. And now there are two issues that we need to solve. So somehow we need to simulate signing sessions involving the honest user, even though we in fact don't have the secret key, because this would be our DL challenge. And then we would somehow want to use the forking lemma and fork the execution of the adversary to obtain this exact secret key in the end from the forgeries. And because the secret key is again the solution to our DL challenge, we could output that in the end. And somehow the forking lemma will take care of the probabilities. So of course, this is, as I said, it's really just a sketch. So I really skipped the two hard problems here, but let's have a closer look. First, let's have a look at how we would do the forking. So this is, maybe you've seen this in other Schnorr signature proofs or proofs of similar schemes. This is in fact pretty standard. The idea is we have the execution of the adversary. So those dots here represent random oracle queries to the random oracle hsig here. And at some point we will try to fork the adversary. So we send different responses for the hsig random oracle. And the idea is that in the end if this was the forgery query in both executions of the adversary, so if the adversary forged the signature using exactly this hsig query, then in the end the forgery will contain two different values for s. So in one part of the execution we will get this s value, and in another part, in the second part of the execution, we will get a value s prime, because c prime has changed, right? Because this is the where this is the point where we forked. So C is in fact different in the two executions. We get those two values, and we can extract X from those two equations. Now in music one, it's actually more involved. We do the forking twice. So in fact, we do double forking, and the reason is that we not only need to fork for h sig, but we also need to fork for this other function h arc. And the idea is that we do this in a nested fashion. So in the end, we run four executions of the adversary, and for each of the two main branches here, we can extract the secret key x using using these equations, and then we have two different secret we have two secret keys x here, and then we can extract our own secret key x1 from x, because remember the public key was a combination of all the signers of all the signers public keys. So also the secret key is a combination of all the signer secret keys, and we want to extract our own secret key, not just the combined thing. And we can do this via this equation then, because we can fork at another query here. If you couldn't follow this, I could understand. but bear with me. The important thing is just here to understand that we will in the end run four executions of the adversary. And this will become important later. But anyway, feel free to ask questions if anything is unclear at this point.
So in the real execution, did we compute AIs by running H twice, this yellow H twice?
What do you mean by real execution?
By the ordinary signature generation. So did we have AI is equal to H of XI with all the public keys?
Right.
Like or this one here. So did we have AI with like this AI with HI here?
Ah. Yes, we do this with all. So yeah. So the equation you wrote there is true for all. So in the real scheme, we compute a different coefficient for every participant.
And okay, but
we have the H2. In this example, we have one. This example, sorry, just have one more public key. But the forking we only do for for A1.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
So the protocol is the same for everybody, but to make the proof work, we fork only for this A1 query where the public key is the one of the honest participant.
Okay, yeah.
Because then we get that these two assignments here in the end are the same, but those are different, and we can from the two X's we can extract what should be X prime, sorry, and we can extract X1.
Yeah.
That's the idea here.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Sorry, yeah. Should have pointed this out. Are there more questions? Okay, cool. Then I guess let's go ahead. On my sketch, I had two challenges, right? The first challenge was how to extract the X1 in the end. This is on this slide. The other challenge was how to simulate signing sessions. And this is the really crucial part for the number of rounds then. So how would we simulate signing sessions? Here on the right, I've drawn the protocol again. Let's say the adversary is on the right side and, for example, uses here only one public key for simplicity, and we are on the left side. So we're the reduction, we control the honest public key X1, and we need to simulate this half of the protocol. And usually how this works in Schnorr signatures and normal Schnorr signatures and invariants is that the reduction B can cheat using the random oracle and just choose random values S1 and C up front. So it will in fact choose the response to the challenge, and the challenge that is usually obtained via the random oracle, it will choose them up front and then compute the nonce from this, and then just program the random oracle such that it all makes sense and the adversary doesn't notice. This is how we usually simulate signatures in a proof of the Schnorr signature scheme, just by exploiting the programmability of the random oracle. But the crucial thing here is that to make this work, the reduction B needs to know this value R here. So the combined nonce R1 times R2 up front. Why is this necessary? Because it's involved in this value is involved in the programming of the random oracle here. The issue is that if we wouldn't know this up front, so for example, let's say we drop this first round here, then we would have sent R1 already, and now the adversary can do a lot of H-sig queries with different R's. And we would need to guess which one of those we want to program. We can't program all of them because we have committed to R1 already in a specific value. So we would need to guess which one to program, and then we lose some probability in the reduction, and because we would lose it in every signing session, and we would have an exponential loss. So we can't make this work. And this is exactly where this first round here helps, because now everybody needs to commit on the non-stable use. So at this point here, the reduction already knows R2 of the adversary, and of course it knows its own R1. And so at this point, it can compute the R already and then do this programming. And then the adversary, of course, can query different H-sig queries, but at this point we don't care because we did the programming at the right position already. And this is really what the purpose of this commitment round here is in the security proof. Okay, so could we get rid of this? Maybe, but if we get rid of this, then programming the random oracle doesn't work anymore. This is what I've shown you on the slide. So could we do better? Maybe the one more discrete logarithm problem could help us here. So one more discrete logarithm, what's that? I also call it OMDL here. It's a natural generalization of the discrete logarithm problem. And the idea here is that the adversary gets, instead of just one challenge, it gets some number k of discrete logarithm challenges from the challenger. And now what we get in return is that we can ask for, or the adversary can ask for k minus one oracle queries. And it wins if it computes the DL of all k challenges. So basically you get k challenges, but you can ask k minus one discrete logarithm oracle queries. So we have to compute one more than you get oracle queries. This is why it's called one more discrete logarithm. And this has been used for other interactive variants of Schnorr signatures, for example, for blind signatures. And in a sense, if you look at it from the point of view of a reduction now, which plays the adversary in this OMDL game, this kind of lets the reduction borrow some DL oracle queries, because it can get the challenges up front, so it can use the oracle queries now, but it only needs to solve all challenges in the end. So it, that's why I call this borrow DL queries. You can exploit this to get some DL queries now, and you kind of have to pay them back only at the end of the execution. How would this look like if we want to use this in our proof? And spoiler, yeah, it doesn't work. It's very tempting. So this is in fact where the proof, the first proof of MUSIC 1 with the two-round variant was flawed. So the idea here is, we had a reduction. We get this one DL challenge. Call it U. We set it again to the public key. This is the same, and also the extraction from the forking lemma and the forking and so on will be the same. The only thing is we now use OMDL to simulate signing sessions. So let's say we have first rounds now. We don't have this commitment. Sorry, we have two rounds, so we don't have this commitment round. So in the first round, what we now do is we just go to the DL challenger and get a new challenge, I'd call it V. And we send this as our nonce. So in the first round now, we don't need to commit, right? So we directly send the nonce. And this is what we do. We send this nonce and we don't even know the Skid Logger rhythm of it because we obtained it as a new DL challenge. But now the cool thing is in the second round, we now can just compute the challenge now normally without programming the random oracle. So we don't cheat with the random oracle model here. But now the trick is that we now, because we obtained this one DL challenge, we get one discrete logarithm query in return. And we can just use this query here to compute the value S1 that we need to send. This is the basic idea. And it's very similar to other interactive variants of Schnorr signatures. I mentioned blind Schnorr signatures. The idea there is in fact very similar. And then at the end of the game, after the extraction happens, so after B10 has learned this X1, we have for every signing session we have an equation of that kind. And using that equation, because in the end we know X1, we know C, of course, we know S1 because we obtained it via the oracle. We can compute R1, and R1 was the discrete logarithm of the challenge that we obtained at the signing session. So for every signing session, we get this equation, and for every signing session, we can compute the D-log of the nonce we sent and solve all those DL challenges plus the one here that we solved anyway because we have X1. This sounds like a working idea. Let me ask you, first of all, are there any questions again up so far? And I always try this in my talks. Is there anybody who suspects what the problem here is? What could go wrong here?
Why does B know X1?
You mean here?
Yeah.
I skipped this. So after the simulation, we still do double forking, right? So in the end, we will still extract.
Okay. So it's the same extraction as before.
Right. Yeah, I didn't put it on the slide because it's the same. But for extraction, okay, we don't change anything. We will learn X1 in the end from the forgeries using the forking lemma and so on. And this then in the end gives us the possibility to compute all the values that we didn't know beforehand. Okay, so if feel free to jump in if you see where the problem is. But if not, it's no shame because as I said, the first unfortunately, the first version of Music One with the two-round scheme was broken too, and the authors didn't see this issue. The issue is that because we do the forking, the forking point of H-Sig could be in between here. So it could be the case that there is an open signing session where we did already the first round, but we didn't do the second round. And then the forking point arrives. The session is basically opened before the first round is done before the forking point, and the second round is done after the H-Sig forking point. And what goes wrong here is just that after the forking point, we forked H-Sig, right? So all these queries will be different now. This could mean that for this one signing session, we have different Cs in the two executions of the adversary because we forked hsig. And this means that we need different DL queries here to answer and to simulate the second round in both of the executions. And in a sense, this means we got one DL challenge, but we used two DL queries here for one session. And this is just one too much. We can't do this because the numbers don't fit anymore. Yeah. In fact, I have this on my slide. So C will change because we forked H6. So we get C prime, and then let's see that this one here changes. So the issue is that we use too many DL queries. Just again, as a graphical representation, we have a challenge here, then we get the fork. So this is where the first round happens. We get a challenge, then we get a fork point. And then in the second round, we need one query for this execution and one query for this execution. So we need two queries, even though we got one challenge. This doesn't work anymore. In fact, it's even worse. Because I explained to you that we use double forking, right? So we may have, in fact, up to four executions of the adversary, and then we need up to four DL queries for just a single challenge. In the end, it doesn't matter for this proof here because it's broken anyway. Two is already too many, but four is even worse. Okay. So this is where the proof was wrong, and this is how we can fix it. The idea was, let me put it this way, that we obtain one discrete logarithm query per nonce that we use. So can we just, if we need four DL queries, can we just get four nonces? And in fact, yes. So the idea is we get the reduction for the DL challenges, and the idea to make this work is that every signer, instead of sending one nonce in the first round, sends four nonces. You maybe could call it now a pre-nonces. So, but we send those four group elements, and then what we use as an effective nonce is a random linear combination of all these nonces. So we get, again, random exponents here. This is pretty similar to how we do the key aggregation, in fact. And these random coefficients here are derived, again, via random oracle. Random oracle model solves everything here. So this query here seems pretty long, but you don't need to pass this. Basically, this, think of this as the transcript of the protocol so far. So all nonces that have been sent, we don't concatenate them, we multiply them here. This is just a minor optimization, and the parameters of the signing session. So the public key, the combined public key, and the message that we want to sign. So think of this just as the entire transcript of the protocol. And this is the main idea. And how does this help us in the reduction? Well, now in the first round, we don't obtain just a single DL challenge, we get four of them. And now we send those four nonces or pre-nonces, which are the four challenges. And then the second round, we use the discrete logarithm oracle to compute the value s, and now because we have two forks, we might have four executions, but that's not a problem. So we might need up to four DL queries, but now we have four DL queries because we got four challenges. And then at the end of the game, again after the reduction has learned the x1 via forking, we now have not the single equation for each signing session, but now we have four equations involving the four DLs of those elements, which I call R11 to R14 here, with different random coefficients now and different Cs here. And using these four equations, now we can extract R11 to R14 again and solve the four DL challenges here. And the randomness introduced by the random oracle here. So the fact that the coefficients are random ensure that these equations are linear independent. Are there questions up to that point again?
I have a question. So when you get four challenges, mm-hmm. aren't you only allowed to get three discrete logs? Because wasn't it k minus one?
So the full picture is that we still learn this one here, right? So the public key we send is the last challenge in a sense.
Actually, we are getting five challenges, including the public key.
Yeah, right. If you have one signing session, so it's one plus four times the number of signing sessions. So we get one fix. This is the public key, and four challenges for each signing session. In the end, we solve that one. This is the one for the public key, and then using that one, we solve all the others. So that's in fact one more than still.
Okay. Yeah. We always have the public key, and that's one. Right. That's the one that we are solving. Okay.
Indeed. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. And now I told you all of these equations are linear independent, right? Is this even true? Interestingly, not in all cases. So depending on the group size, we actually may need even further nonces if you do the exact calculations. Just to make sure that these equations will end up linear independent with overwhelming probability. For example, if you do the exact calculations for this group SegP 256K1, which is used in Bitcoin, so this elliptic curve, then we in fact would need five nonces to make this probability negligible. Now, can ask, okay, so, well, five nonces. I promised you a simple scheme, right? Doesn't sound too simple. One could ask if in fact the requirement that you need even four nonces, or then because you need four, even five nonces, could be an artifact of the proof technique, and we think it is, because if you try to prove this protocol secure in a stronger model, in the algebraic group model. So if you don't know the algebraic group model, it's a different model for the elliptic curve group, or for groups in general. It's somewhere in between the standard model and the generic group model. So it's really weaker than the generic group model, but it's still stronger than the standard model. And the nice thing about the algebraic group model is that, for example, for normal Schnorr signatures, we wouldn't need the forking lemma in the proof. So we can get we can do the proof without any forking. And this then means that we also avoid the double forking, and we avoid the need for four nonces. In fact, then we only need two nonces. Of course, you could then ask, hey, if you don't need to fork at all, why doesn't it work with one nonce even? The simple answer here is that I've shown you that there are attacks against the scheme with one nonce, right? So it can't be secure. What I've shown you so far is, of course, only the ROM proof involving the forking lemma. And this AGM proof seems very technical and cumbersome. So I really don't have an intuition for that. You get a lot of equations in the end, and you need to argue about all the equations. And this just boils down to a huge case analysis over the scheme and over the games. It works out, but it's really, I don't have any intuition for what's going on there in the end. But anyway, so in this work, we present music too, and really finally after 1 hour of talk, I can show you the scheme. Again, at an example for two signers, so they have keys x1, x2. We do the key setup as with music one, so with those coefficients. Nothing has changed there. But what has changed is that we dropped this commitment round, so you don't pre-commit to your nonces now, but what you do instead, you send two instead of one nonce. So this is now the variant secure in the AGM model, which has two nonces. So everybody sends two nonces. Then we compute the effective nonce of every signer using these random coefficients B, and which are again derived via a hash function. And then we can compute the combined nonce, which is again just then the multiplication of the two effective nonces of the signers. We can get a challenge, and then everybody answers with S. So now I told you that the scheme is simple, right? And I stand by this claim, because the only thing we introduce in a sense is the blue elements here. So we drop one round, and what we do instead is we get those blue things, and this is really, really simple. It's just one more element on the wire, and it's a few exponentiations here in the hash function. But apart from that, we don't add anything to the scheme. And now I said, I talked a lot about two rounds versus three rounds, right? And you can ask, okay, if we anyway need an interactive scheme, is it that important to have two rounds instead of three rounds? The cool thing about Music 2 is it's actually better in a lot of cases, because what we can do is we can pre-compute this third round without knowing the message. And this makes signing effectively non-interactive. So you can, in a sense, you can pre-share the nonces from the pre-nonces from the first round, and then just wait for a message you want to sign. And when, as soon as the message arrives, just signing is then only one round, because locally everybody can then compute their S value and broadcast it to the others. For example, in a Lightning channel where a message that arrives could be a new payment that you want to forward or that you want to do, then it's even easier because we only have two participants, right? So message could arrive at one point, at one of the two participants. This participant signs it locally, produces the S value, and sends the message and the S value over to the other participant. And then the other participant already can form the full signature. So it's really non-interactive in this setting. And this is a novelty in the pure discrete logarithm setting without the pairing. So even the other schemes, the previous schemes in the discrete logarithm setting that don't use pairings and where two round schemes don't have this particular property that you can pre-compute the first nonce. For example, I mentioned the music, the N on my slides. In this scheme, you couldn't do this. There was also another scheme by Treves et al., which is different because it doesn't output Schnorr signatures, but it's still in the discrete logarithm setting. And also two rounds, but also they didn't have this property. And I believe you probably can't do better without pairings. Of course, if you have pairings, then you get BLS signatures, which are super nice when it comes to aggregation, because you can just non-interactively aggregate them. So you get basically multi-signatures for free and they're non-interactive. But as long as you don't have pairings, and in Bitcoin, we don't have pairings, I think this is, when it comes to round efficiency, at least this is the best you can come up with. Okay, so to recap, our key technical idea to make a two-round scheme work is that every signer uses a random linear combination of multiple nonces, let's call it them pre-nonces then, as this nonce. And this is where I should mention that, interestingly, this idea concurrently appeared in at least three works. So in our work, it also concurrently appeared in the Frost scheme by Chelsea Comlow and Ian Goldberg, which is more in the threshold signature setting. So we focus on multi-signatures, they focus on threshold signatures, but the idea to make a two-round scheme is using multiple nonces is exactly the same. And also the same idea appeared in an e-print by Alper and Burgess, again in the setting of multi-signatures as we do it. The differences between those works, except that they are maybe in a little bit different settings, is that we believe that our from provable security side, our proof is a little bit better than the others because I've shown you this how to make the simulation work, and in the ROM proof, this doesn't appear in this Alper and Burgess work because they only work in the AGM proof. They also get a proof there, but they don't manage to get a ROM proof. And for this work, the difference is that they also didn't write up a full ROM proof, but they introduced a heuristic step to make this idea work in their proof. So I believe in terms of security and of provable security, we are a little bit better than those two works. But in fact, it's very cool to see that this idea appeared in three works at the same time. I've never seen this in my career, to be honest. Maybe it happens that there are concurrent ideas, but not by three research teams. That's pretty cool, and it shows that there is interest. First of all, it shows that there's interest, a lot of interest in this area. And second, it kind of confirms our ideas, right? Because if three research groups come up with them independently, then it can't be too bad.
I think we are a bit over time.
Yes, I see this. So I have, I think, two slides left. Maybe I can quickly go over those and then I think I'm done. So the provable security, just to sum this up in one table, depends on the number of nonces. So just again to mention this, if you have only one nonce, then there's an attack, so can't make this secure. If we have four nonces or maybe more, we can get provable security under the OMDL assumption in the random oracle model. And if you have two nonces, you can get security under the OMDL assumption in the combined models of random oracle model and algebraic group model. Well, if I present it like this, then you could ask, what's the story for three nonces? In fact, I don't really care. Of course, I'm joking here. I'm pretty sure this proof here for two nonces would also apply in the three nonce case, but it's not interesting, so we didn't do it. To summarize, MUSIC 2 is a multi-signature scheme where signatures look like ordinary Schnorr signatures, which is great because they're compact, they have fast verification. It's a very practical scheme. It offers a simple two-round signing protocol. And in fact, the first round can be computed without knowing the message, which makes signing almost non-interactive. And it's concurrently secure, depending on the parameters in either the random oracle model plus the algebraic group model or just the random oracle model, both under the OMDL assumption. And if you're interested, we have a preprint online. In fact, I hope we will update it in the coming days because there is a tiny optimization that we did to key aggregation where you save one exponentiation. Not a big thing, but we wanted to write it up. And we think we can have this online in a few days too and update the preprint. Okay, that's it. Sorry for being a little bit over time.
That's okay. Thank you very much, Tim. Yeah, since we are a bit over time already, I think we can take the questions all the time. And I guess I already asked my questions. So.
Yeah, right. Also for those who are watching the recording, please feel free to reach out to me and ask questions. And just for the chat, I'm always open to.
Exactly. Questions, so if you have any questions, feel free to drop an email. And thank you very much again, Tim. And hope to see you all in the next seminar. Thank you, everyone.
Right. And thanks for having me here. Yeah. I appreciate it.